shift gears now to epigenetics and the idea that personalized medicine is not just in the genetics, which is the sequences that we inherit from our father and mother, but there's a whole world above it, which we call epigenetics, that plays an important role in who we are. But the main difference between epigenetics and genetics is that epigenetics is dynamic. It just tells us the story of who our father and mother were, but it tells us the story how our life was going through, as you will see as we talk about. So in the beginning, we thought the world is simple. We have the four letters of DNA, and it will make us understand how genes work. But we learned very fast that just the letters of DNA are not enough. For example, our liver and our heart will have the same DNA, but very different destinies, very different forms. So it seems that one DNA can do millions and billions of different things. And if you think of it, if I sequence your DNA, I don't get much information about how this DNA is going to function, because that DNA can function in a million different ways in our own body. And that leads us to the next question, which is, how do I... child is born into this world, the kind of relationship that that child will have with his mother will define a lot of his phenotype or her phenotype. And that relationship could happen here in this posh neighborhood of Miami or in the slums of Rio de Janeiro. And that will have a huge impact on that person. It will have an impact on his blood pressure, heart, how long he lives, how he behaves. How does this work? So, I will show you today that epigenetics plays a very important role in mediating all of this, how it feeds into our DNA, and the huge potential that that has for medicine, both therapeutics and diagnostics. And this whole story started from an accident. I went into a bar in Madrid, and I met in Spain. And I met a friend from McGill that I never knew what he was doing. We were both in the same university. But he was in the mental health institution. I was interested in cancer. And he told me about licking rats. And you see, anybody who has done experiments with rodents know that this is how rats treat their babies. But what he noticed is that not all rats do it the same way. So if you have a group of rats, you can count how many times they do that. And then when these rats grow old and their mother is long dead, there's a huge difference between the rats that got a lot of licking and grooming and the rats that didn't get licking and grooming. For example, the HPA axis, the axis that defines the stress response, is different. So the rats that receive high licking and grooming are not stressed, they are not sexually aggressive, they behave well. The rats that didn't receive a lot of grooming, licking and grooming are highly aggressive, they're highly stressful, they don't know how to cope with stress.
So in the beginning, this was soft science, you know, how, who cares whether rats lick the pups, and what happens with this? But then you think about this, how is it possible? How does the rat remember how much licking it got when it was a baby. So you can give two answers. One answer is genetics. The rats that lick a lot probably have a different gene than the rats that lick very little. So you can spend many years looking for a SNP and find the difference between those rats. But you can do a simple experiment that shows you it's not genetic at all. It's not the genes that they carry. Because what you can do is cross-foster. You can divide the rats of the low licking and grooming and give it a different mother that is a high licking and grooming. And you take the rats from the high mother and give it a low mother. And you ask the question, is it the biological mother or is it the real mother, that the mother that takes care of you? And the answer is clear. It was the mother that takes care of you, not the mother that gave birth, but the mother that takes care of you that defines the female. So it's clear it's not genetic. So these two rats can inherit exactly the same gene, but if they receive a lot of licking and grooming, they will behave differently than the other rats. And think about it in the context of personalized medicine. So how does it work? We spent, Michael, Mimi, and myself, my colleague, and McGill spent 10 years to sort out how this works. It's not magic. It's all biochemistry. So the mother licks and grooms. She elicits in the brain a pathway, serotonergic pathway. Serotonin goes up. Then it picks up a signaling pathway. It leads protein to the genome, which bring in epigenetic enzymes. And if the rat licks a lot, the gene looks like this. And if the rat licks little, the gene looks like this. So this has two meanings. First, if you want to understand how you behave, it's not enough to sequence your genetics. We need to know what else is on it during the life that you got. The second thing, the difference between genetics and epigenetics is the genes are very hard to change. Even with CRISPR, it's very hard to change. But epigenetics are all enzymes. And we can use drugs to change it. So we could take the adult rat that now looked like he had a high mother and give it a drug called Tetrastatin A, an epigenetic drug, and it converted it to be a high animal. And we can do the opposite. So on one hand, epigenetic is very stable. The rat has the epigenetic sign when it's old that it had when it was born. On the other hand, pharmacology. So here you have an illustration of a huge potential impact. Not only you can find out what's the difference, but you could also try to do something about it. So we believe that what happens is that early in life, when a baby is born, he's born with a genome. That genome comes from his father and mother, and it's a consequence of human evolution. But that's not enough. Because the genome doesn't know if you're going to be born in Beijing or Tibet, or you're going to be born in Shanghai or Tibet. And if you're born in Tibet, there's much less oxygen than you're born in Shanghai. If you're born in Stockholm, the nights and the day are long, the nights in the summer are very short, days are long, and opposite in the winter. If you're born in Ecuador, it's equal. The genome doesn't know that. So the genome needs to receive signals. What kind of world I'm born in. And the mother serves as a vehicle, as a vector for mediating this. So we have three different environments. We have the bioenvironment, which is all the bacteria and the horses in the farm and the dams and the dogs and the cats around that completely change your immune system. You have the physical environment, which is the how much light. Is it cold? How much oxygen? All these things. And the social environment. Am I going to be born to a rich father where life will be very comfortable and food will always be there? Or am I going to be born to a poor father? Am I going to be born in a place where I'm the only kid in a big house? Or am I going to be born in a place where there's 75 other kids in the same house? All this information, we suggest, goes down to the genome. And tweaks the epigenetic profile to prepare the child to deal with this world. But you know what happens sometimes? The world changes.
And even though you programmed yourself to deal with the world, for example, you were born in a very poor house. And that means you won't have a lot of food. That means your brain, whenever it sees food, should binge it. And your metabolism, whenever it gets a food, should turn it into fat, because you don't know when your next meal is coming. And then you live in the United States, and a McDonald's costs 99 cents. So calories are cheap. So even poor people can have a lot of calories. So this whole process becomes irrelevant. And what happens in rich countries is that poor people in rich countries tend to be more obese than rich people in rich countries.
If you go to poor countries, it's the opposite. Rich people are obese and poor people are skinny. And so what happens is that sometimes the epigenetic programming doesn't fit the world and you get disease. Another example is, if you were brought in an environment that your mother tells you, this is a really bad and mean world. You have to be aggressive, you have to be anxious, because you don't know where the next shot is going to come. And then you've developed into a middle class school that tries to teach you to be a nice citizen, and you have this aggression, you'll become a misfit, and you'll develop mental health disease. So you can see how epigenetics, which was created by evolution to help us, to prepare us for that, can sometimes cause disease. And therefore, epigenetics is, in our opinion, a key to understanding both health and disease.
By this kind of model. So we wanted to know other examples, get closer to us, the humans. So another collaboration that I had with Steve Sumi, Steve Sumi did a very simple experiment. When monkeys are born, rhesus monkeys, he takes them away from their mother, and he gives them a nurse to take care of them. So they have a nurse taking care of them, and these animals have a mother. And when you go and look at these animals, when they come old, they are different animals. They behave differently. They have different cardiovascular disease. These animals, they become fat and the other don't. These animals, if you give them alcohol, will binge to death. So they develop all these symptoms that we see in human societies. And the only difference was that they didn't have a mother when they were born. So we tried to
look if this is also mediated by epigenetic processes. So we mapped the epigenome of the mother of the animals that had a mother and those that didn't, and measured the difference, both in the immune system, T cells, and prefrontal cortex. So you see all these peaks here are areas where DNA methylation is different between animals that have a mother and animals that don't have a mother. So we can see that the response to even a social signal, like not having a mother, is not limited to the brain, but also carries to the immune system. And how early do we see it? After 40 days, we took blood from the monkeys, and you can see that after 40 days, we measure methylation across the genome. You have two clear groups of monkeys. Monkeys with a mother, and monkeys without a mother. And that gives you an illustration
of how the environment, in this case a very social environment, no drugs, no poisons, no pollution, just not having a mother, has on your immune system. And when you look at the pathways that are affected by the lack of another, you can see some very common pathways that are involved in many kinds of human disease. So these pathways that are now responding to the lack of mother. Because when you don't have a mother, it means life is going to be very hard. You might be attacked by other monkeys. You might get injured. You might have to develop an immune system that can deal with this. But now you're sitting in Maryland, where your scientist gives you all the food in the world and you're never attacked by any other monkey, this becomes now a source of disease.
We then wanted to know, how early does the social environment impact your epigenome? So monkeys, like humans, they develop hierarchies. You notice in a plane there's always the first class, the business class, and the economy. You put three monkeys in a room, one monkey becomes the first class, the other one becomes the business class, and the third becomes the economy. The monkeys that are in the bottom of the pile are extremely stressed. And so we ask the question, a mother that is in the bottom of the pile, and a mother that is in the top, like upper class and lower class monkey, what will happen to the methylation, DNA methylation, of the baby when it's born at the moment that it's born? Before the baby did see anything, the baby never saw
any other people, any other monkeys, but he was pregnant. He was in the womb of a mother that had high status. And you can see the huge difference in DNA methylation. So every line here is a different gene. Red is more methylated, green is less. And you can see how nicely they separate between the high rank and the low. Being in low rank is bad news, as you know, both in humans and in animals. They will suffer from disease, they will live much less, and they will have trouble all their life. So it's very important to predict which baby had a very tense pregnancy. So we tested the possibility that these could be markers of social rank during birth. So we applied some statistical methods and found that only two genes were enough to tell whether the monkey comes from a high social class mother or a low social class mother.
So this is personalized medicine. If we can take placentas of teeth, babies and birth, and find out whether they have developed those risk genes, because these genes are going to be a risk gene for their entire life, and provide higher enrichment to these babies. Does it work in humans too? So we studied, humans are very difficult to study, as you know. The problem with humans is that they're different, and when we measure social stress, we don't know whether it's the genes that cause the difference in social stress, or is the social stress that causes the difference in the world. So we need to do randomized control studies in humans to kind of eliminate those problems. But you cannot do randomized control challenges unless you are Adolf Hitler or somebody like this. So you cannot do a randomized child abuse to ask the question,
in humans, does it also work this way? But sometimes God does experiments. And the way God does experiments is natural disasters. So one of the natural disasters in Quebec, in my province, was the Quebec ice storm of 1990. The entire province of Quebec lost power for between 6 hours to 6 weeks, so randomized treatment. And people, of course, mothers, now think about mothers who were pregnant during the ice storm. The temperature is 30 degrees below freezing, and you have no heating, right? So that's stressful. So no, because Quebec is a very rich province and knows how to organize itself, nobody died. But people had to move to shelters, had to move to other places, and that created a huge stress, but the stress was quantitative. Not everybody faced the same stress, and it was totally random. Nobody knew where he would be. There was no plan ahead. Your genes didn't define where you're going to be. So we
know that it's a clean study. And we asked the question, when these children grew, and my colleague Suzanne King in Quebec followed these children. Now they are around almost 20 years old. But when they were 15 years old, we took blood from these children and asked the question, did the stress of the mother correlate with the way methylation works in the offspring? And so this is a Lumina 450K genome-wide analysis of DNA methylation across the genome. And you see here is the stress is increasing. So we had a social measure of stress, and we did a Pearson correlation between the social measure of stress and the DNA methylation in the blood, in the T cells of the children. And you can see this group of genes are becoming less methylated, and this group of genes are becoming more methylated as stress increases. But you need to know about these kids.
These kids had a higher rate of autism, that's the social environment, had a higher rate of asthma and other ectopic disease, that's the immune environment, and also are starting to develop sugar intolerance and metabolic disorder. So it's quite clear that both the DNA methylation has changed, but also the phenotype by the level of stress during birth. So can we use that to establish a stress methylation score? So we can know if a child was exposed to high volume of stress by his mother or through his mother that he needs more attention. So we developed a polygenic DNA methylation score, and we can show that that score correlates beautifully well, as you can see, to the amount of stress that the
mother has suffered. So if you give me your blood, hopefully one day we will be able to tell what were the risk factors that you carried from the experience of birth. These have nothing to do with the sequence you inherited, but it has to do with the experience that you went through during childhood. So we believe that one day these will change psychiatry, because the psychiatrist to see a patient will not need to ask him questions, but to have some objective measure that will be indicators of stress. So we talked about what happens when you're a baby, but experience can affect you at longer times, even when you're an adult. For example, you went to a party and somebody gave you cocaine. That's an experience that will have long-term consequences. Or you were in a car accident, or in an earthquake, or in a war, and you suffered from trauma.
And what happens, people develop either addiction or PTSD when this goes through. But the amazing thing is that not all people do. If I come to a class and give cocaine to 30 high school kids, only 10 will become addicted. 20 will not. So it's highly personalized. If you go to a car accident, 17% of you will develop PTSD. The others will not. So here we have a very good example of an experience, a strong experience, it's an adult experience, but that can affect people in a very different way. So we wanted to see if DNA methylation is involved in the response to cocaine and in being addicted. So we use an animal. We use an animal model. We teach the rat to take cocaine. It's like what happens when you go to your high school class and somebody
gives you cocaine in a party. And then you know what happens? You go home, you forget about the cocaine. For a month, or 2 months, or 3 months, you don't see cocaine. And then after 3 months, you see cocaine. And what happens is that, so we do exactly with the rats, they don't see cocaine here, and here we're giving cocaine. And what happens, when they get cocaine at this point, they become super addicted. So something is happening when you're not getting cocaine at all that makes you super addicted. So we found out, and here is this. This is the level of addiction the rat has after it learned about cocaine. And this is the level of addiction that the rat has a month later without seeing anyone. So we found out that there is a massive change in DNA methylation. I don't know what happened to the slide. You see, not there. Got some Chinese characters on it.
But what we can see is that many, many genes are going through changes in DNA methylation during the incubation of cravings. So just think about it. There's no cocaine. There was cocaine many times ago. And now you're changing the way the methylation is programming your brain. And then when you see the cocaine the next time, the whole system is fired. So the beauty of epigenetics is that, as I showed you with the rats, it's reversible. So we asked the question, can we use a drug that will reverse the animals that are addicted to become animals that are normal? So we took two kinds of drugs. Drugs that inhibit DNA methylation and drugs that promote DNA. When we did that, we saw that if you give the drug immediately after the animal learns to do cocaine,
there is no effect. But if you give the drug a month later and pair it with the cure, in psychology we call it CBT. It's cognitive behavioral therapy, which is you show the animal the party, in this case the animal sees the bedding, and you give the drug at the same time. And then, as you can see, the addiction weapon. But what's nice about epigenetics is, once we reprogram it, unless there's new cocaine coming, there's no removal of the code. So we treated the animal only once, and came back after a month, and again, there was no addiction relative to the control. When we get the methylation promoting drugs, we got the absolute opposite. Now they became super addicted, and this
remained also for a long time. So epigenetic programming is different from any other treatment that we have given. Because what we're doing is we're removing those signals that early adversity or addiction has left on the DNA. And they're not going to come back unless we will suffer the same experience. The last thing I want to talk to you about is a rat model of PTSD. So PTSD is another behavior. And we can measure PTSD by using three different kinds of behavior. I won't elaborate on it. And we have three kinds of response to trauma. One is you didn't expose yourself to trauma. The other one is animals that go through the same trauma but don't develop any PTSD. We call them resilient. And the third group is animals that develop PTSD.
So you know how we traumatize the rat? We have a cat walking on a cage, and the rats are terrified from it. And many of them will develop PTSD, around 17%, like humans, will develop PTSD after. So we can do two things. First, ask the question, is the epigenetics different between the animals? They have the same trauma, but one group of animals develop PTSD and the other group. Is there a difference in that position? And since I'm a pharmacologist, I'm not just interested in differences, I'm interested in solving those problems. So can we use epigenetic drugs to remove the PTSD from them? So we did the methylation mapping of the three kinds of animals, the susceptible, the resilient, and we found that there are differences in epigenetics between the susceptible and the resilient animals. So answer to question one, yes. Epigenetically, the animals that will respond with PTSD are different than the animals that will become resilient to PTSD, will not develop PTSD. The second question we asked was, what are the pathways that are affected? So we did a whole genome analysis, and we found two interesting patterns. One was DNA methylation. So the animals, which is the epigenetic itself, so these are the animals that were not traumatized, these are the resilient animals, and these are the susceptible animals. So there's difference in total amount of methylation. But there's also differences in the amount of the enzyme that methylates people. And these are the differences in expression of the enzyme. And there's a good correlation between the amount of enzyme and methylation. So we thought the first thing we need to do is see if we can promote methylation, can reverse the PTSD. The second thing we found is that retinoid acid receptor is affected in the susceptible animals. You can see it here. So we have now two pathways that we can work on, the retinoid acid receptor pathway and the DNA methylation. And all this information came from an epigenetic analysis. And what we did is, first, we injected a virus that expresses DNMT3A or retinoic acid into the brain. And we can show, so these are the three behaviors. One of the behaviors is exploration. A normal rat, when you put it in a new environment, it will just walk around to find out what's going on. If the rat has PTSD, it just will stay like this. So you can measure that. The second thing is social interactions. An animal, normal rat, if you put another rat in the cage, they will look around. Like, we look at each other and say, how am I, Moshe, I'm this. Whereas a rat that has PTSD will just freeze. And the third behavior that they're different is
called hyperarousal. If I show you a picture of a war, most probably you won't react to it. But if you have PTSD, you will become hyperarousal when you see a picture of a war. So we do the same for the rats, and we can measure the behavior. So the susceptible animals have very high freezing in all behaviors, as you can see. But what we can show is that with the treatment, we can bring it down. DNMT3A or retinoic acid receptor. The next question was, this is not practical, right? You cannot treat people by injecting viruses into the brain. And so is there a drug that we can use that will do the same?
So what we did is we treated the animals with SAM, S-adenosylmethionine, which is a methyl donor, and retinoic acid, and we can show that when we combine the two treatments, we can completely revert the behavior, the PTSD behavior, in all three behaviors. So these animals reverted to normal by giving them this combination. So the last thing that I want to tell you, and I won't show you much data, the cancer is not any different. And the same way that you can use epigenetic to measure risks for behavioral disease, for addiction, for PTSD, you can use for cancer. This is an example of polyCV markers, a polyG marker for staging and preventing hepatitis
carcinoma that we developed here in collaboration with scientists in Beijing, with the Yuan Hospital in Beijing, with President Li and his team. And you can see that we can take a sample from the blood and stage the cancers accurately by using a DNA methylation marker. So I think that to conclude, the epigenetics is going to change the face of personalized medicine.
It is what personalized medicine is all about, because the difference from genetics, it doesn't only report on your father and mother and your history of evolution, but it also reports on the experience of your life. So as we go through life, life is like a movie where different actors are coming into our life and changing the movie of our life. So life is not just the script, a series of letters, but it works in 3Ds, and that information
has power not only to personalize our approach to people, not only to know their history and experience, but also to design new kind of therapies that go to the underpinning causes of human disease and understand the whole process by which we are so heavily affected by the environment and by our experiences.
side effects,
right? So we measured, there were zero side effects, so which is amazing. Animals that are treated by epigenetics, this kind of epigenetics, SAM and this. People are treated with SAM. People take SAM and buy SAM. It's a nutritional supplement. Same is retinoic acid. So even though they cause epigenetic changes, we have people who use these for 40, 50 years and have no really clear side effects.